So first I wish to thank, really thank the organizer for this nice opportunity, and also I like all the pattern chosen with the exercise sections. Let me start with the commercial about the conference. This is the mega conference, is every 2 years. Next time in 2015 will be in Italy, June 15-19, and if you are interested you can Google Mega 2015 Trento, and I especially recommend young people to Google there, because well, you can see there is a deadline for papers, which is really soon, but there is a deadline for poster and for computer presentation, which is March 15, and probably many of them of people in the audience here could be interested, and especially there will be at least 60 grants for lodging in Trento for young participants. And I recommend interested young people to apply soon for them, okay? Because...
What is the definition of young?
Well, in some sense, not yet tenured. You are not young here, I think, but you can. And, well, Anthony also is in the committee. Anthony, oh, you are here, okay. And, okay, this is the end of the commercial. Now I start with the talk. So I start with the variety, which I called X, is a projective variety in PV. Let's assume it's not containing any hyperplane. Pick a vector V in the vector space. So sometimes I switch between affine and projective, which is quite convenient. And the first definition everybody knows, but let me recall that the rank of your vector V with respect to X is R. What means? Means that you can write your vector as a sum of R points, which are in the cone of X, and R is minimal, so this is the minimal decomposition. Okay. So I will do some example very soon, but let's do a second definition, which is the second degree with respect to X of V, and this is just the number of minimal decompositions. And this is quite important in the applications because V is called X identifiable just if this second degree is one. So when this number is one, what this means? This means that there is a unique decomposition. So from V you can recover uniquely Xi, and this has a lot of striking application in the tensor decomposition, like in the talk of this morning, X is just the Segre variety, and we in the classical Segre embedding, but also partial symmetrization or total symmetrization when you have the Veronese are quite used, and sometimes there are interesting objects. No question?
Is second degree?
Yes.
Or is finite?
No, no, could be infinite, could be infinite. Well, this question are quite both, this definition are quite both not algebraic, probably you, and now I will show, indeed I expect some complaining about the definition, but if you accept them, I will show that there are some critical cases when you want to apply this definition. So let's start with example zero. in example zero, I take just v equal to, that's the most trivial case, probably the quadratic forms into variables. So these are given in this way, a x squared plus 2b xy plus c y squared. And what is x? Well, if you think these are 2 times 2 matrices, I can write down the rank 1 matrices, which are just the particular polynomial which are square. And now you can draw a picture. X is just a conic, and this is V. Of course, there is a trivial case when V belongs to the conic, and then the rank is 1, but is V is here, obviously you can draw a line. You find x1 and x2, and the sum of x1 and x2 in a convenient representative in the cone, you can just write a sum avoiding the scalar, is your V. But also, you can draw another line and get x1 prime and x2 prime, and you find another decomposition, and you can find as many as you want, of course, changing the line. So in this case, for this special V, the rank is 2, and the second degree is infinity. And let me quote a very nice paper by Ranestad and Schreier called Varieties of Polar Simplices, when they study precisely all the possible decomposition, generalizing this case to all the quadrics, so sim2 of Cn. And in all cases, the second degree is always infinity, which means that the possible decomposition make a positive dimensional variety. So from some point of view, these are not good for application, because you never can detect the decomposition from V. So let's go to next example. You see here it grows the dimension of the space. Now let's just do a small step in the degree. So sim3, c2, which are just ax cubed plus 3b x squared y plus 3c x y squared plus d y cubed. So these in classical language are the so-called binary cubics, and x is just given by the cubes. So the particular polynomials which are a cube of a linear form. Now, if you want to draw, well, x is the so-called twisted cubic. Indeed, is usually example one in any course in algebraic geometry, if the conic is in the example zero. And now if you have your V, and you want to write down your decomposition, there is a nice way to study how V can be decomposed. Think that in V there is a lamp, which makes a projection, and here is your screen. And if you project from V, what you see in the screen is just this picture, because it's a rational cubic which has a double point. It's a double point somewhere. And so this is a special point. You can follow your point, and you now get x1 and x2. And this is the, if this is a node, that this is the unique node with this position, and it's clear that for every other point, the fiber will be only 1. So this proves that the rank is 2. And the second degree is 1. Okay. But now choose a different point. You can draw, for example, let's make the screen a bit larger in your mind, and consider here a tangent line, and take your V prime here. Now, what happens if you put a lamp here and if you project, what you see in the screen is now this picture. So it is a cusp. And now everything changes here because you have no more 2 points. So you see, from the algebraic point of view, well, they behave, this fiber is always of length 2. But if you really want to decompose in the application this tensor, well, the rank of a V prime is 3 now. It's not possible to write down this V prime as just a sum of 2. You need 3, because there is no a node here, and the second degree is infinity. Okay? So this makes an interesting thing, and now last example. Before to give the example, let me tell you that this works and can be generalized. I will tell something more in a moment about all binary forms behave usually the secant degree is 1 for general tensor of fixed degree if D is odd, and odd and even make some difference here. So last example is now take four-dimensional vector space to the projective space, and X is V22, the complete intersection of two quadrics. So this is an elliptic quartic curve. At first glance, you can think that this has anything to do with tensor. Clearly, these are tensor cases. This seems different. But I will show you at the end of the talk that this surprisingly comes, this example comes very naturally in a tensor space, trying to do a tensor decomposition. So what happens here? Well, the drawing looks the same at the beginning. You take V and you project. Now what happens? What happens that now the genus is 1, you get a quartic here of genus 1, so the number of double points is 2. This is for general V, this is the projection, and now you get 1, 2, x1 and x2. Oh, I draw maybe too small, but too close. That's x1 prime, x2 prime. You have two possibilities, so you can write down this decomposition and also another one. Okay? And these are the only one of rank 2. So the rank with respect to x of v is again 2, but now the second degree is also 2 because you have two minimal decomposition. And that's quite interesting. There is also an intrinsic geometric way to study this too, because there is a pencil of quadrics, so there is a unique quadric containing the curve and passing through V, and these two lines are exactly the two lines in the ruling of your smooth quadric if V is smooth. But may happen that your quadric is not smooth here. And this happens, for example, if you choose a bad point like here, so a point in a tangent. So it may happen that if you choose V prime here and you project, what you see is in this way, one node and one cusp. Still is an elliptic curves. And now that's quite interesting, because the rank of V prime is again 2, because of course here you have the composition. And now what's the secant degree? Well, since I have a background in algebraic geometry, My answer up to some year ago was that also this should be two. But if you speak with applied people that really want to find honest decomposition, you understand that these two could be not the right answer. So I defined this in a very naive way, and in applied world this is the correct answer, because really there is a unique tensor decomposition, and from this point of view even this V prime can be better than V, because this has unique decomposition and this not. So you see that the picture, even in simple example, it's quite interesting, but don't mind, I want to show you that using algebraic and geometric techniques we can detect and study these things, of course.
I would have thought the point of uniqueness was that you can go to linear equations. And this doesn't look like you have linear equations to determine.
Well, of course you have a multiplicity. But if you want to write down how many decomposition do you have, the answer is one. So I agree that it's not algebraic and I accept the complaint. But the same complaint, I think, should arrive even for the rank, because why here the rank is 3? It should be 2, because you have a multiplicity, so maybe the...
I'm making a different complaint. I understand what you're talking about, but here where you have two different kinds of secants, and you say, well, the secant degree is 1, so it should be identifiable. It's not identifiable by linear equations, I think, nevertheless.
That's true. That's make probably more difficult to find explicitly.
I think
so. Yeah, but in principle you can, because you can find both and then quotient on the bad one. And
can't you with this? Can you change your projection so that for any v you'll hit on some tangent of your quartic?
From any v?
Yeah. So not use the same projection. Use a different one. And then can you make it so that you will get a tangent and where you hit the quartic on some tangent point?
I think you're asking whether the tangent lines fill out space.
Sure.
And they don't.
Okay.
Thanks. If the union of tangent lines is a surface, so it's always generically you find this is the generic, luckily that's the generic answer. Well, just by dimension count. You have a line and you have one parameter family of lines. Okay? So, well, I already used 20 minutes for the example, but I think examples are quite important. And now, as I promised to the organizer, I want to show how you can play with these things using Macaulay 2, and this morning already in the very nice talk by Mike we said and we saw many examples of tensor decomposition. So I want to pick any symmetric tensor now, since and n equal 2 is quite easier and important in a while, the one of binary forms. We call Cn. Okay, let's call Cn. Then from T, well, it's a polynomial, you can get what Sylvester called the catalecticant max, which are sim d minus e cn dual in sim I cn. And the classical way, very fruitful, of thinking about these things, and which is the space of differential operators, so you have some delta belongs to here, and you just apply your derivative to t. So depending of t, you have this contraction. So how write down this map? This is very basic with Macaulay. So Macaulay has a very, very nice command, which is diff. to the maybe the naive way to use diff is just write in this way. This means the partial derivative of any thing, maybe it's dangerous to any polynomial with respect to x, but can be applied in other setting. F could be a matrix, and then you get the derivative in one time of all the matrix. But also x could be a matrix, and then you contract a matrix with another matrix, and this is wonderful for this point of view, because if you want to write down these things, you can do the following. You take, assume that your ring is called R. Then you know that basis IR is just the space of polynomials of degree I. Then you can differentiate.
This is the n variables or n choose?
N variables, yeah. Diff about the transpose, so basis D minus IR, and you think that these are all the differential operator of degree D minus I, so apply like here. Now, if I want to use that in this setting, sorry, I should reverse my numbers. Otherwise, I get the transpose. Okay, don't worry for this. This is just up to transposal. I usually forget and I try one of the two and then I transpose if it's not correct. So, and then you differentiate for basis IR and you apply to your F. So this is an example of what I said before. The first diff just essentially compute all the derivative of f, so you get a vector. And then you apply a vector to another vector. And so what you get at the end is just the map of the catalyticant. So this is a catalyticant. Now, of course, there is a problem that this is just a scalar matrix and you get a scalar vector. And you expect that in the kernel you get polynomials. So you could do the following. If you take the kernel of catalyticant and you just multiply on the left by basis IR, this is in a clean notation, gives already all the differential operator of degree I, which kill f. So this is a basis of the apolar ideal in degree I. And then you can play with this, do for any I, you can find the generator of apolar ideal and many other interesting things. So I choose not to turn on the computer. It's a bit strange that I write Macaulay to program on the board, but if all of you has any question, then during the problem session can simply ask me. And also I think I could not have any possible compare with the talk of the founder of Macaulay 2 this morning. I'm just a beginner that learn.
Did you define the polar idea?
No, I don't define it now. It's there is a very nice, probably you know, because Frank Schreier has a very nice script that computes, but I it was anyway defined in other. Okay, then some tricks, some Macaulay 2 tricks that can be useful. For example, I gave an exercise when you have to decompose a binary form, And often you cannot do on the rational, of course, even if your input is rational. So you have to solve some some polynomial equation. So in one variable, like in this case, so for solving fx equals zero in one variable, which means if you dehomogenize the homogeneous polynomial in two variables, a very quick way, you have not to exit Macaulay, go to MATLAB, and then you can do everything inside Macaulay. And the command I recommend is eigenvalues of the companion matrix of F. That's very quick and do immediately in a fraction of a second all the roots. And sometimes, as also in the exercise I gave, you have some parameter and you want to know in advance if you expect that all the solutions are real or not. So what happens if you work over the real? So now you can define what is called the Bezutian. You take the trace of the companion matrix of F at power I plus j, and you define the matrix which at ij place has exactly this trace. If F is real, this is a real matrix that you can compute in a second. And then Sylvester did most of classical things. A very beautiful theorem says that B is positive definite if and only if F has real and distinct roots. And this of course requires some study, but the equation are given by all the, you can check eigenvalues again, for example, and B is a semi-positive definite if and only if F has real roots. Okay? Also, another command I recommend from this numerical part. Sometimes you want to know the rank of the catalecticant, but if you have written with approximation, so if you have real numbers, you cannot apply rank just in precision. So in Macaulay 2, there is another very useful comma, which is SVD, singular value decomposition. And if you look at the singular values which are significantly different from zero, you understand what approximately the rank here and the rank is. And in the application, usually you find the number and then comes 10 minus 8, 10 minus 13. So clearly some number which is almost close to zero. So the Terracini implementation was done by Mike Stillman this morning. I want to show maybe a last Macaulay trick that can be used about the contact locus. And this is related to the identifiability problem. So how to check if a tensor is identifiable or not. So let's recall I should only write Macaulay. Now it's no more Macaulay. So if V is the sum of xi, so you have this decomposition, then the span of tangent of this to x is contained in the tangent space at v of the secant variety of x, and equality holds for general v x1 xk by Terracini lemma. So the Terracini lemma is exactly the statement that you have equality. Now, so you have V, you have X1, X2, and the span of these two gives the big span here. Now, what happens that if you have another decomposition, a miracle appears that you can detect if you have another decomposition locally even from here. So even if you are very far. And this is again a result of Terracini. But so I think it was first understood in this setting by Chiantini and Ciliberto, but you can find in the way I show now by in the recent paper by Chiantini, myself, and Van Nieuwenhoven. So if the second degree is bigger or equal than 2, and that's the bad condition, but it's not avoidable, if V is a smooth point, of sec k of x. So you see second degree bigger or equal than 2 means you have not identifiability, so you want to get as a consequence something that you can check. Then this locus, which is actually the contact locus, x such that t x of x is contained in the tangent v secant k of x. So you see that x1, xr, of course, lie here. But something more can lie here. So this is positive dimensional. One of xi, and generically at all of xi, if you have monodromy. So, the miracle, which is, now you have a curve here, or maybe a positive dimensional variety, and even if this is quite difficult to be computed, because you need the symbolic, you can compute the tangent dimension, and the again, now it's the tangent space at xi of this contact locus well can be computed by linear algebra if you have four rational varieties, of course, but
wait, so what's the statement of the theorem? It's if
so the assumption is that V is not identifiable and it is also a smooth point of the secant, then this variety is positive dimensional at 1 of xi, and so the corollary, well, maybe I don't write, but if you have that this variety has dimension 0 at x1, then there are two possibilities. Or your v is bad, so it's a singular point, or the secant, or it is good if the secant degree is one. So it gives in some sense a criterion of identifiability for smooth points, and you can apply generically. So like this morning, Mike wrote, thanks. This morning, Mike wrote some random point and applied there a Terracini computation. You can do the same, writing down random points and compute them the dimension of these, which in coordinates, this is the rank of some Hessian matrix type. So you have many, many Hessian depending on the number of equation which cut your x. So this analysis has been done for Segre and Veronese variety. Now I will tell you some result of this analysis. But if you look at archive papers and in the paper, there is a tech file, but there is also some ancillary files. There are some MEM2 codes. And one is this one. And let me mention also another with Luke that will come now in a while important. You can find the code which allow with Macaulay 2 to compute all these things. Okay, so the result so now what happens that sometime you find a smooth point and this contact locus at zero dimensional, then you can guarantee 100% that it is an identifiable point. But if you find some positive dimensional, it, with high probability, is not identifiable, but you have to do some further analysis because maybe you are unlucky. Well, it happens that in all the cases when this happens to be exceptional, some theoretical analysis can tell you why it is exceptional. Like this morning in the list printed by Mike, there was a list of defective Segre. For all them, it's easy to see that they should be defective for some reason. The difficult part, which is still a conjecture, is prove that there are no others exceptions in general. So in the theory, I think still there are many things not yet proved. It should be very nice to get a complete proof. So before to write a theorem, let's write just a philosophy, which comes that maybe you guess by computation. So to write down this philosophy, and I think that this should be true for general X, let's write the generic rank is the rank of general element. And let's call X is called K identifiable if the general V, X is in PV, of rank K is identifiable. So this means that generically for rank K you expect some identifiable element. The philosophy is the following. First point, if R is smaller than the generic rank, then X is R identifiable unless some exceptions. Now what happens if R is equal to the generic rank? Now you get just the opposite. X is not R identifiable unless some exceptions. So this philosophy has been tested for X equal to Segre, Veronese, well, and a few others. Of course, one should wonder what means a general variety, which has no meaning because you should look at the Hilbert scheme. But these, in some sense, are prototype of could happen for all rational varieties, and because this comes as a projection from here. And let me tell something more about what I write. So, at first glance, if you read what I've written, this seems counterintuitive, because here the behavior is that identifiability and the not identifiability are exceptions, and here is just the opposite. The general behavior is not identifiability, and the identifiability should be the exception. But if you think a bit more, well, this is exactly what should expect if one has some grain of salt that I had not until I did some computer computation, because the fact that you have in general not identifiability is related to the fact that you have some secant degree, which is the degree of some difficult variety, which is difficulty expected to be one. But in this case, you have enough room that your variety, a secant variety, is quite free to cover the space, and there should be some essentially a uniqueness of nodes, like here, generally, if you have enough freedom to have a space. And in the application world, this philosophy, in some sense, has been always believed, because in the application, all people try to decompose tensor of small rank. Okay, so usually you get identifiability, unless a few exceptions that in the application is better to avoid, maybe better to know in advance. What is maybe not expected, that you can really arrive up to the general one. It was a bit expected, I think, that there was some intermediate, but the computation in this case seems not to give this answer. And another comment, if this philosophy will be confirmed by some theorem, of course it will be nice, and it's a positive result for application. But the mathematician mind, like me, usually is very curious what are the exceptions, no? Even if maybe that's these are few. But in some sense, the exception allow to understand better. And I think it's not so bad that one is minded to look at the exception. The fact that these problems are difficult are just because we have this exception. All the time I speak with Luca, and I come to him, oh, I have an idea to prove this case. And he never asked me what's the argument, does not want to know. He asked me why your argument fails for the exceptional cases. And so every time you have to look for an argument, you have to be careful that in the exceptional cases, this argument has to fail. And so that's quite interesting. So maybe you are curious too to see some list. And since I have not a slide presentation, I will be very cheap for them. But I will show you some new list that probably you never saw because it's not yet published. And so I think.
So you really think this is true beyond Veronese and Segre? They're awfully special varieties.
Well, for Segre Veronese it's true, and also for Segre Veronese inside, of course, and but they're not general varieties, so I don't care, but yeah, my answer was stupid, yeah, unfortunately it has been recorded, which is but well so I think in Chiantini talk, which is also has been recorded last week, there was more list about this case. So let's concentrate about this case. And in this case, the contact locus approach fails miserably. There is no hope to write down a contact locus because when the secant space is all the ambient space, the tangent space is everything, the contact locus is everything, you cannot apply. And in this case, with Macaulay too, we were not able to find any clue, unless you had take a package of Macaulay too, which Anthony Lykin also provided. But I confess we did with the original Bertini in this case, and we have now some recent, well, most of the computation were done actually by John Hauenstein, and then the theoretical study is done in collaboration with Eding, myself, and Andrew Somese. And again, I write this equation that I already wrote many times, and now put a variable here. So think as xit as variables, and think that v0 equal to v1 equal to v, so you make a loop. And here you can apply the technique of the so-called homotopy continuation. So if you start from v0 equal to some xi0, then homotopy continuation is very, very well behaved, that you can follow your solution when v moves. So you move, here you have a Vt, and locally you can solve numerically this, and you do a loop, and the nice thing is that when you come back, V arrive just at the same point, but often the solution changes, and can change in many nice ways. The obvious way is that just that this summand for monodromy permute each other. But sometimes you find a completely different. For example, in the case of the elliptic curve, when you have two decomposition, you can usually find one from the other just by a monodromy loop. The only thing is that this has to avoid the bad part of the space when you have no more a honest decomposition. But this bad part has a real codimension, at least two. And since this is a path of dimension one, for random choices, this works very well. And so this allowed us to guess some new cases. And
so when you have degree D, do you expect the monodromy to be the symmetrical?
F- for general polynomial, I think so. Yes, I think so. Well, but I think that's the philosophy of Joe Harris, no? And all the cases he analyzed in all the paper he had. This is, in some senses, very surprising. I was very surprised by this result, because how you do just randomly and never avoid some part, but seems to be true. So I have 7 minutes to try to write down. So let me recall the classical symmetric identifiable cases. And they were one series. So the first one is sim dc2 for the odd. And this is also the only one which is quite easy to be shown. That was shown by Sylvester. Is generically d plus 1 choose 2 identifiable. And this is the generic rank.
Choose 2? You said choose?
No, it's a fraction, not choose. D plus 1 is even, and then you divide. Then there is a sim 5 c3. Which is 7 identifiable, and this is very popular because it is a letter who Hilbert wrote to Hermite. Now I have no time to enter in historical details, but it's very nice. This letter is published anyway. It's in French, so. And then you have sim 3 c4, which is 5 identifiable. And this is really a beautiful theorem, is Sylvester pentahedral theorem. Often when people study the cubic surface, the first amazing result is the 27 lines. But here is more deep, much more deep than the 27 line. There is a pentahedral, so there are 5 lines canonically associated to a general cubic surface, including all the smooth ones. And so just to be concrete, this means that if this is your surface, you have a unique sum of cubes. This means 5 identifiable. And this can be found uniquely. Now, the homotopy continuation technique now allowed to study many more cases which were not possible before, and we did not find any other, which I think it was quite expected. But if you look at the number, something nice appear. For example, what's the secant degree of these cases? So, I wrote in a bad way. I should write the secant degree of VD of P2. And this is D. So, for 5, it is 1. For 6, it is infinite. For 7, it is 5. This is Dixon-Stewart. For 8, it is 16. And this is Ranestad-Schreier. And this is really deep result proved by Syzygys. For 9 is infinity. And now with 10 is 320. Let me write with high probability. And this is quite a huge number. And the next cases comes Sue Haig over four digits, and there were no other cases. And also for cubics we tried and there were no other cases, and for Segre variety they were the so-called pencil of matrices, is generically identifiable. I think it's N identifiable in this case. And indeed you compute by eigenvalues here. And that is due to Kronecker and Weierstrass. And then with my surprise, two new cases appear, and we were not able to find them in the classical literature. So 3, 4, 5 is generically 6 identifiable, and we have a theoretical proof of that. It was guessed with the computer, but we can show with vector bundle, with Macaulay 2, now we have a code that allowed to write down how the decomposition can be found. So this is in collaboration with this bunch of people. And also, there is this case, which is now only 4 identifiable. And all other cases we tried, they are not identifiable, so it's very natural to conjecture that there are no more. Also, this case can be proved theoretically. And so it's nice that now you have a canonical form for just for tensor of 3, 4, 5, but non, there is, of course, no proof that there are no other cases, and in general, only some computational guess, and should be quite interesting to understand more. So, my time is over, and I thank you for your attention.
Question?
So just a comment. I mean, in order to, if you study identifiability in the generic rank, you need some numerology needs to work out. Otherwise, you will know.
Like, I mean,
there is a reason why infinity appears in 6 and 9, and that's because the total dimension is not divisible by 3. That's how the expected dimension goes. Every time you gain a secant, you gain 3. So unless you're perfectly divisible by 3, you will not have a chance. You will know that it's positive dimensional. So.
Yeah, thanks. I forgot to tell this fact. What Greg is saying was called the perfect by Strassen. So the perfect case are the one when the secant variety fill exactly the ambient space, no more, no less. So it's arithmetic condition. And this, of course, can be written also for Segre varieties. This is a necessary condition to have identifiability, but far to be sufficient, because there are infinitely many cases which are perfect according to this remark.
I guess the Kronecker-Weierstrass theorem is the decomposition of matrix pencils, basically. Is there some nice canonical form for 3, 4, 5?
Probably there is, but up to now we were not able... yes and no, in the sense... You can write down as common zero lossy of vector bundle sections. But this is also, in our interpretation we gave with Luke, who is here, about Sylvester pentahedral, the 5 planes can be written as 5 points which are zero lossy of a vector bundle section. And the vector bundle section is the kernel of some generalized catalecticant that you can write down with Kozul. I used for the catalecticant 2 application of diff. In that case, you have applied diff 3 times. This really, Macaulay 2 is so beautiful because in one line you can write down a big matrix and the kernel of the matrix gives. And this works also here. But I don't know if this answers your question. So there is a geometrical structure, but not so easy as maybe. Well, maybe you can, these are in some sense generalized eigenvectors, but the dimension is not the same. So speak about eigenvectors is a bit.
Giorgio, what can you say about the Grassmannian in the space of symmetric tensions? Do you have a?
So I'm pretty sure the philosophy applies, but nobody up to now did some big search. Well, there is a famous case about not only Sylvester did the things, also Corrado Segre, and he studied wedge 3 of C6, and this is too identifiable. And if I'm not mistaken, that's the only case I know about Grassmannians. There is a paper by Mukai when he studied many G over P. There is one spinor variety, and so probably there are no others, but I have no enough experience to. It should be a very nice project, of course, yeah.
Ask a similar question. So in application, I think these tensors will be sparse. There'll be many zero entries. So what about the coordinate projections of these varieties? Have that been studied?
Well, I see what you mean. Sparse, of course, is difficult to be stated geometrically, but it's a challenge to be understood. There were some... well, in the literature, there are some papers, but maybe I should refer to papers of you and your group, I think. So I have no direct experience, I think, yeah.
If you look at the set of tensors of, say, border rank R, where we have infinitely many different positions, what do we know about this variety? I mean, does it have complex four-dimension one? And
you mean in the border, when the rank is different from border rank?
It's like the ramification points. These are the bad tensors, where we don't have, we have an infinite number of decompositions. So these are like the ill-posed tensors. So what do we know about the set of ill-posed tensors? Do we know that, is it four-dimension one?
So you mean how many decomposition do you have? Well, in the...
would like to understand some of the geometry of that. So do we understand this?
I think in the binary case, this is understood, and often you have just a P1 of the composition when you bunch. For example, this is true in the... for D even. Well, no, this is not you asked. What you asked is, for example, what happens if you have a cusp in... and not a node, and again, well, but it's true that in this case, if you have the twisted cubic and you lie here on a tangent and you get the cusp, well, just play taking any plane through this point meets generically in 3 points, and this gives the composition, and they are all the minimal ones. By in this case, it's really easy because the degree coincides with the. In this case, you get the P2 of the composition, not the P1. Yeah, it was. So the number is probably, when you expect finitely many and you have one more, the number of the composition, the parameter is the dimension of the variety plus one, I think. That's.
Maybe I can add a comment. So the incidence variety always has the correct dimension, and the dimension of the fiber is what we're counting. So if the fiber, the locus of points which have a positive dimensional fiber, has to have lower dimension than the other locus, right? So it should have.
You say.
We take the incidence variety of points plus decompositions, and then we're projecting to the space of points.
But the codimension, could it be more than one of the in some cases?
I think that. Especially in the non-perfect cases.
So this would be nice because then it would be very rare to have such a badly conditioned one.
there are no more questions, let's thank Giorgio again.
Thanks.